Hello students, in the previous session we have discussed about the disorder sickle cell anemia, the Mendelian disorder. So now we'll continue with the next disorder, that is phenylketonuria. What is this phenylketonuria? Phenylketonuria is an inborn error of metabolism inherited as autosomal recessive trait where an affected individual lacks an enzyme that convert the amino acid phenylalanine into tyrosine, resulting in accumulation of phenylalanine, which in turn is converted into phenylpyruvic acid and other derivatives. In a simple term, we can call this as an inborn error of metabolism, or we call it as a genetic disorder. So this is inherited by a child. Or we can tell this is an autosomal recessive trait, that is the gene responsible to cause this disorder is present on an autosome and it is recessive. So in this case, what happens? An individual will not be able to produce an enzyme called as phenylalanine, which is responsible for converting phenylalanine to phenylpyruvic acid. So now, let us try to understand what is the cause for this phenylketonuria. So this is mainly caused due to the recessive gene, which is represented as small p on chromosome 12. As I told you, this prevents the synthesis of phenylalanine hydroxylase, an enzyme required to convert phenylalanine to tyrosine and further reactions. So therefore, hence, the main cause for phenylketonuria is the presence of gene in recessive condition, that is on chromosome 12. So this is an autosome. So since there is a recessive gene, the enzyme phenylalanine hydroxylase is not synthesized. Now let us come for the symptoms of this phenylketonuria. First thing is, since there is absence of the enzyme phenylalanine hydroxylase, phenylalanine gets accumulated in the blood and it is converted into phenylpyruvic acid and other derivatives. So therefore, accumulation of phenylalanine is the major symptom. So because of the accumulation of phenylpyruvic acid and other derivatives of phenylalanine, what happens? Their concentration increases in blood, their concentration increases in cerebrospinal fluid, and as a result of this, there is mental retardation in the child. The third symptom is, since the phenylalanine is accumulated in blood, so this is excreted through urine because kidney cannot absorb it. So therefore, phenylalanine is excreted through urine. This is the third important symptom. Fourth symptom is seizures. What is the seizure? That is pits. So partial seizures can be seen, or partial pits can be seen. So these are the symptoms of tremors, trembling and shaking. This is associated with seizures. So the other important symptoms of phenylketonuria are stunted growth, then hyperactivity, the child is more active, and skin condition, that is, there's a condition called as eczema. What is this eczema? In this, patches of skin become rough, they have inflammation with blisters, which causes itching and bleeding. So therefore, it's also associated with the skin problem. So, and other important symptom is a musty odor of their breath, skin or urine, that is, an unfavorable odor, or an intolerable odor occurs if you sit next to that person who is infected with phenylketonuria. That is, might be they have skin with a foul smell, or even they are breathing, you cannot tolerate their smell, and even when they urinate, naturally their urine will be having somewhat a foul or unfavorable smell. So these are the major symptoms of phenylketonuria. So now let us come for the treatment. Usually, since phenylketonuria is a genetic disorder, it is not curable. For not only phenylketonuria, for any other genetic disorder, there is no treatment. Then what to do? So usually we can take precautionary measures. That is, if PKU is diagnosed early, that is during the baby development or during the fetus development, through the chromosomal test, if we come to know whether the child has got phenylketonuria, then we can try to make this child not to become mentally retarded by controlling the concentration of phenylalanine in blood. That is, diet containing less amount of phenylalanine can be given, or even some medication to control or to reduce the concentration of phenylalanine can be done. So this is only to promote, what can say, the brain development. Other than this, we cannot do any other treatment for this phenylketonuria. So therefore, this is with regarding to phenylketonuria. So now let us come on to the next disorder, color blindness. What is color blindness? It is sex-linked disorder caused due to defect in either red or green cone of eyes, resulting in failure to discriminate red and green color. Or we can tell that this is a disorder which is sex-linked recessive disorder, in which a person is unable to identify red or green color, or a person is unable to discriminate between red or green color. It's not a major disorder, but in case of metros, if a person travels through vehicle riding himself, so then the traffic signals, so there this can cause a problem. Otherwise, it is not a major disorder leading to death or like that. So therefore, it is, we still, since a person cannot differentiate colors which a normal person can identify, this is considered as disorder. So now, when was this color blindness discovered? When you go back, trace back the history of color blindness, this was first discovered in 1798 by a chemist called as John Dalton. So he published a first scientific paper on color blindness. So what is the cause for this? As I told you, this is caused due to mutation in certain genes present on X chromosome, a recessive X chromosome. So what is the rate of occurrence of this color blindness? So basically, this disorder is more commonly seen in males when compared to female. That is, 8% of males are known to exhibit this disorder, and if you come for females, only 0.4%. What is the reason? That is, red color blindness is more commonly seen in males because males have only one X chromosome, and the chance of that X chromosome being recessive is also more. Whereas females, they have two X chromosomes. So even if one X chromosome is recessive, there will be another X chromosome which can be dominant. So female will get this disorder provided if both the X chromosomes are recessive. Hence, the chance of female getting both the X recessive chromosome is very less. So therefore, the rate of this disease is less in females. Then, you, as I told you, the sun of a woman has got 50% chance of being colorblind because son receives one of the X chromosome from the mother. So even if mother is not colorblind, if she has got a recessive gene, then what happens, this will be expressed in son. Whereas if it is daughter, since daughter gets one X chromosome from father, if it is dominant, the recessive X chromosome of the mother can be reduced. So therefore, as I told you, a daughter will not be normally colorblind unless mother is carrier and father is colorblind. So a carrier mother marrying a colorblind father can get two X chromosomes. I mean, the daughter can get two X chromosomes from this parent, and chances of the daughter being colorblind is more in that case. But sons, even if mother has got one X chromosome recessive, the son has got maximum chances, or he has got 100% chance of getting what we can call color blindness. So now let us come for the color blindness characteristic features. That is, this is present only on X chromosome, which is passed to her son by mother. In other words, colorblind follows criss-cross mode of inheritance like hemophilia. That is, let us say a father has got a colorblind. So then this will be passed to his grandson via daughter. So therefore, this follows criss-cross mode of inheritance. Children can inherit colorblindness from a mother who is colorblind or from a mother who is carrier of the gene, but it is not colorblind herself. Daughters of men who are colorblind will carry the trait, but sons will not carry. So this is the other important characteristic feature of what we can call colorblindness. So now let us come for types of colorblindness. So this is not major for you. This may not appear to you in your exam. But still, since we are studying about colorblindness, let me try to give a small note on the types of colorblindness. I told you, in this case, a person is unable to differentiate between red and green color, and also there's one chance of blue color. So depending upon the color which a person is unable to identify, colorblindness is mainly categorized into two things, red-green colorblindness and red-blue colorblindness. So red-green colorblindness, what is this? This is mainly due to the loss or limited function of red cone or green cone. So, you know, we have got color identifying cells in retina, that is cone cells. So, therefore, in this case, the cone cells are unable to identify red color or green color. So, therefore, this is a major type. And this is further categorized into four types. Protanomaly, where a person, what can say, is not able to identify red color, and in this case red, orange and yellow appear to be green for him. So this type of protonormally, a type of red green color blindness, is known to occur only in 1% of males. Second one is protonophia. In this case also there are no working red cells, and in this case red appears as black color. Orange, yellow and green appear as yellow color. So therefore, this is the second type. This also is known to affect 1% of males. So again, I'm stressing this need not be studied for your from your PU board point of view. The third type of red color blindness, deuteronomaly. In this case, green cone cells are abnormal or they are not able to function. So therefore, in case of this person who has got this deuteronomaly, yellow and green color appear red, or it is difficult to tell violet from blue. So therefore, this is a mild type of green color blindness, and it is known to affect 5% of the males. So this is the third type of red-green color blindness, deuteronophia. In this case also green cone cells are not working, so therefore red appears as brownish yellow, green as big. So therefore this is known to affect about 1% of male. So remember, color blindness, the first type is red-green color blindness. Then the second type of color blindness is blue-yellow color blindness. So in this case, blue or yellow color blindness is rare than red color blindness. So blue cone are missing, and they are, if they have got limited function. So in this case, the first type is tritanomaly, where people in this with this disorder, blue appears to be greener, and for them it is difficult to tell yellow and red from pink. So this is again known to affect males and females equally. Then tritanophia. People with this blue-yellow color blindness lack blue cone cells. Blue appears green, yellow appears as violet or light gray. And this is again known to affect males and females equally. So, but this is a rare disorder. So therefore, in population, we have got less population, less number of people suffering with blue-yellow color blindness. But most common color blindness is red-green color blindness. So now, let us try to see, this is the different color pattern which is going to appear in case of people who are suffering from color blindness. So you can see the colors of rainbow, normal color vision, and a person who has got what we can call red color blindness, you can see the red for him, it will appear somewhat greenish in color. Likewise, the color of rainbow in case of a person who has got what can say where green cones are absent, so it is going to appear, green color is going to appear as red. So this is somewhat we can tell how the color is going to appear in the infected people. And as I told you, color blindness is going to follow crisscross mode of inheritance. You can see here, man has got a recessive X chromosome containing gene for color blindness. Women is normal. So when they marry, and you can see the children, so the daughters all are carriers. One son is normal, and both the sons are normal in F1 generation. You see, if this carrier woman again marries a normal man, so you can see one daughter is normal, one daughter is carrier, one son is normal, and one son is color blind. So therefore, here the gene of color blindness, which is present in father, is passed to his grandson via daughter. Hence, this follows criss-cross mode of inheritance. So this is with reference to color blindness. So next, we'll be discussing with regarding to another disorder, that is thalassemia. That will be in the next slide.